Okay, the final item of business this evening is a members' business debate on motion 12917 in the name of Jamie Halkett-Johnson on importance of wood-burning stoves and other direct emission heating in homes in rural and island communities. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, but I invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I invite Jamie Halkett-Johnson to open the debate up to 7 minutes, please.
Up to 7 minutes. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking colleagues from across the Chamber for supporting my motion, allowing this important debate to take place. Can I also thank representatives from across the industry and other stakeholders for their engagement and their advice, and of course my constituents from right across the Highlands and Islands for providing their experiences and concerns as to why this ban is so dangerous. Of course, we now debate this with the Scottish Government having committed yesterday to a review of the new regulations, a review announced just the day before this debate was to be held and one forced on them by a concerted campaign led from these benches to drop these new regulations. Regulations, remember, that the Scottish Government brought in less than 2 months ago. But as I said yesterday, I do welcome this review. We still have no real detail. Yes, I will.
Christine Graham.
I want to be terribly friendly to you, but I'd just like to correct you. There were SNP members who were also concerned about the restrictions on log-burning stoves, and we signed your motion, and we're here today.
Ms Graham, if I could remind you to put your comments through the chair, please. Jamie Halkett-Johnson.
Well, I very much welcome that, and I have made the point in the past that absolutely right yourself, Christine Graham, two former ministers and the current Deputy First Minister signed my motion, and that appreciation from across the chamber is very, very much welcome. As I said yesterday, I do welcome this review. Unfortunately, we still have no real detail on what it will include, when it will start, how extensive it will be, and of course, when it will conclude. The Minister said it wouldn't start before the summer recess, suggesting that even if we assume a September start date, we're unlikely to see it concluded or action taken before the end of this year. I'm happy for the Minister to take an intervention on that.
Minister.
Yes, I believe I said yesterday that it wouldn't conclude until after the recess. I didn't say that it wouldn't start until the recess. It has already started.
Mm-hmm. Jamie Halkett-Johnson.
Well, that's welcome clarification. I'm grateful to the Minister for that. And it does matter because, as I'll speak to you later, the new regulations are already having a serious impact on the sector and on the future resilience of rural homes. Presiding Officer, I ascribe this ban as dangerous, and that's not scaremongering. For many homes in my region and for those living in our rural and island communities, wood-burning stoves are not a luxury item. They're an absolute lifeline, providing heat, hot water, and a means of cooking when power goes out, as it often does. In December 2022, over 5,000 homes in Shetland were left without power, some for many days. Hundreds were left without power last December because of Storm Garrett. Earlier this month, thousands were left without power overnight because of damage to the network. And only last night, more than 1,300 properties in Shetland suffered an outage, with more than 100 homes still without power this morning. And I've experienced that myself in Orkney. We were left without power for 5 days because of extreme weather. The only source of heating and cooking we had was our wood-burning stove. The roads were blocked, and had we needed it, help couldn't have got to us easily. And I know many families across the Highlands and Islands will have found themselves in similar position. Those of us who live in rural Scotland know we'll lose power. It could be snow, it could be high winds, it could even be geese flying into lines. Power outages are not unusual. So we have to be allowed to be ready for them, because we can't just pop next door when we're snowed in, and we can't always rely on emergency services being able to get to us quickly. That's why this ban shows just how little the Scottish Government understands the needs of rural and island communities, because it will leave families less able to deal with bad weather and power cuts. And I call it a ban, and I know the Scottish Government will be keen to claim otherwise, because that's what it is. Scottish ministers will claim that emergency heating may still be considered. But the updated technical guidance states quite clearly, and I quote, that in smaller buildings, including dwellings, there will be little justification to install emergency heating. It also says that any appliances can only be used in emergencies, must be connected to the normal heating system, and must have electrical backup. So where previously a wood burner would have been sufficient to provide heat and cooking in the event of a power cut, my constituents in the Highlands and Islands looking to install a wood-burning stove in any new build now would be forced to connect it to their central heating system and to emergency power source, probably a diesel generator. And that has significant technical and cost implications. And that, of course, presumes permission would be given in the first place. Yet we're already seeing wood burners blocked by local council, planning and building standards departments. So new homes are already being built with reduced resilience. And that's why this is a ban on wood-burning stoves in all but name. If I can turn to the economic impact, last week the Scottish Conservatives met again with the stove industry and others and heard from them the damage this is already having on their businesses. One told us that for the first time in 10 years, they had no installations in a month. Another reported footfall down by 80%. One was warning staff of potential redundancies. There are over 2,000 people working in our sector, and we were told that if other industries were treated like this, there would be uproar and the Scottish Government would act. But it is this Scottish Government that is causing all of this uncertainty. Yes.
Briefly, Minister.
Would the Member accept that maybe some of the misreporting around this, saying that it is a ban on wood burning stoves, which it never was, has maybe led to public thinking that they can't have wood burning stoves in existing homes, when that's never been the case, and that might have contributed to this issue?
Jamie Hulker-Johnson.
Well, it's interesting the Minister says that, and welcoming the news yesterday of this, of the review, the Deputy First Minister said the people had got in touch with expressing concerns what was essentially a ban on installing wood stoves in new bills. So perhaps she disagrees with the Deputy First Minister. If I can turn briefly to... Yes, of course.
Deputy First Minister.
I think the point that the Minister was making, and I should point members to recognise that I have a stake in this, but in terms of what the Minister was saying, is that this is about new builds and there was misreporting about it being in all properties.
Jamie Hulker-Johnson.
Well, that may be the case, but that's not come from these benches. Perhaps the Scottish Government should be clearer when they put forward policies. If I can turn briefly to some of the other issues. Firstly, can I thank my constituents, including Andy Whiteman, formerly of this parish, in sharing some of their personal experiences. And they've highlighted how this ban could actually block low-emission heating, including biomass, and I'm sure colleagues will speak more on that. My other constituents have raised concerns about how it will leave households reliant on new technologies, such as air-source peat pumps, that can be expensive to install and prohibitively expensive to replace when they break. One constituent wrote to say their heat pump had broken twice, with it taking 8 months for expensive parts to arrive. Presiding Officer, we didn't have to be here. The Scottish Government ignored concerns raised during the consultation process, and they pushed ahead with these regulations because they're disastrous, now thankfully debunked, but debunked Bute House agreement with the Greens was more important to them than the rural communities of Scotland. Now, I appreciate the Minister is new to her position, and she may not want to take responsibility for this mess, but her Scottish Government have to. This is a ban which is opposed by MSPs from across this chamber. It is a ban which is opposed by key stakeholders because of the damage it is already doing. It is opposed by industry who have worked so hard to build businesses who have, and work with government on emissions, but have now been left wondering whether there will even be an industry in the future. And it has been opposed by the Scottish Conservatives and our constituents across rural Scotland who know just how dangerous it could be. I urge the Minister, save the industry and save lives. That's how serious it is. Don't just review the ban on wood stoves, drop it entirely. Yep. And until then, given the timescales involved in the review and how long it might take to conclude, and with the uncertainty being caused right now, I urge the Minister to suspend the new regulations relating to wood burners until that review is carried out. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hulker-Johnson. Before we move to the open debate, just to advise the Chamber, there is an awful lot of interest in this debate, so I'm going to have to ask all members to stick to their speaking time allowance, or even less, if that is possible. And with that, I call first Alistair Allen to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Up to 4 minutes, Dr. Allen.
Presiding Officer, may I extend my thanks to Jamie Hulker-Johnson for securing this debate, and may I also declare an interest of sorts as someone who cuts peats for my own use. There is no doubt about the importance of stoves in those areas of the country that are off the gas grid and in housing types where there are few workable alternatives to choose from as heating sources. These are, of course, the same areas of the country and the same housing types which presently endure some of the worst fuel poverty. Firstly, I think it is vital in the interests of accuracy to recognise that there is not and never has been a proposal to ban stoves in any existing house. Nor, despite some efforts to sow confusion on this point, is there any proposal for an effective ban on peat cutting. All of which said, there have nonetheless been very many reasonable questions asked by me and many others about what the new regulations on new build houses actually mean in practice. Currently, the proposed guidance would allow people to install a stove as an emergency heat source in a new house, providing that the size, complexity or heat demand makes portable solutions unsuitable. As I understand it, whether a potential property meets these criteria would be down to local authorities. Now, while I remain confident that rural local authorities would understand the unique requirements of rural heating solutions, I am very pleased at the Minister's indication in the Chamber in recent days that the Scottish Government will be reviewing and reassessing these criteria in order to make them more readily workable, particularly in rural and island areas. I'd like to thank the Minister for her correspondence with me on these issues in recent weeks, and I know that many of my constituents are also grateful for her engagement on this matter. Presiding Officer, I would like to think that most of us in this chamber accept that decarbonising our homes is an essential part of ensuring a greener future. However, the importance of ensuring the suitability of these policies for rural and island communities is paramount to ensure that they are workable and do not have the unintended consequence of increasing already high fuel poverty. Many of the houses in my island constituency differ radically from urban homes in terms of their type, their construction. Land ownership types vary, as does the prevailing local climate and energy infrastructure. These also vary widely from other parts of the country. Only 22% of Western Isles homes, all of them in one town, are connected to gas, with the rest currently relying on heating oil, solid fuel, air source heat pumps and electric heating. Power cuts are an unpredictable part of island life, and as such, in many parts of my constituency, solid fuel options are often essential, at the very least, as a backup. Now, while I understand that most will use these stoves to burn peat also remains one of the most common fuel sources in the Western Isles. Peat cutting remains a culturally significant aspect of island life, as well as being an affordable option for many. All of that said, Presiding Officer, nobody, myself included, is suggesting that either peat or wood should be the only or even primary means of heating new homes into the future, merely that there should be provision for the use of solid fuels where this is appropriate, and that guidance should accommodate that and do so more simply. The perfect can be the enemy of the good in writing guidance, and I welcome the fact that the Government is willing to recognise this going forward.
Thank you, Dr. Allen. I now call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Rhoda Grant. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and may I thank my colleague Jamie Halker-Johnson for bringing this debate to the Chamber today, and also welcome many members of the stove industry to the Chamber this evening. On the 1st of April, the SNP Green Government introduced the new build heat standard, which effectively constitutes a ban on direct emission heating systems in new build homes, however which way you want to say it. But yesterday it was confirmed that the new regulations were under review to consider. And I quote from the Scottish Government's website, "The treatment of wood-burning stoves and the wider use of bioenergy systems in more detail. This is a clear admittance that this policy was misguided, it was ill-informed and lacked the necessary detail and understanding of rural communities from the start. The Scottish Conservatives have strongly campaigned on this issue since the new regulations were introduced, and our campaign has amassed over 950 signatures on our petition." Yes.
Briefly, Minister.
I hope Ms Hamilton understands that I had very similar concerns. But given that these regulations went through the Local Government Committee and there was two Conservative members on that committee, did they raise concerns or indeed asked for this to go to a vote before they were passed?
Rachel Hamilton.
Absolutely. Miles Briggs, my colleague, raised concerns. We were the only party to raise concerns in the Local Government Committee. Last week, we held a roundtable event to discuss the impact of the new regulations, which was attended by 40 significant and key people from across the industry, from across Scotland, including stove businesses, chimney sweeps and industry experts. If I may, Presiding Officer, I would like to share a few of the key issues that were raised Many were disappointed in the lack of clarity and detail in the guidance, which left people questioning the practicalities of the new rules. It was also noted that the regulations were open to interpretation by local authorities, leaving the risk of regional differences. Moreover, as I noted in my question yesterday, the new regulations have had a significant impact on the industry that is worth around £60 million and employs over 2,000 people. One company noted that since the ban, they have had zero inquiries compared to 25 in the same period last year. Additionally, another business shared that since the 1st of April 2024, they've had 3 stove installation inquiries versus 20 in the same period in 2023, which equates to £100,000 in lost revenue on previous sales. The impact on rural communities was also widely raised. One member of the roundtable noted, and I quote, "Scottish winters in many rural and island areas are different to the central belt. Electricity can be lost for days, and with no backup heating source, there are people's health and well-being compromised." This perfectly sums up the realities of the new regulations, which reach directly into the heart of homes, depriving rural people of a reliable access to heat. I welcome that the SNP have now admitted that the new build heat standard lacked the necessary detail to ensure it worked for rural communities. But it is a review. It's not a reversal. And that is what we will continue to call for. The Deputy First Minister suggested on social media yesterday that this review shows that the SNP now understand rural communities. But if the SNP really understood rural communities, they would never have introduced the ban in the first place. Let's not be fooled. This is a screeching U-turn, which has only taken place 2 months after the former minister, Patrick Harvey, resolutely defended the policy in this chamber with the backing of the SNP. And while the Bute House agreement might be over, its legacy continues to cast a dark shadow over rural Scotland. The SNP must listen to rural communities by committing to reverse this ban and categorically rule out any similar ban in existing homes. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Eleanor Whittam. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I also thank Jamie Halkrow-Johnston for securing this debate. I also welcome the review of this policy announced yesterday by the Minister. We all know we need to reduce emissions, that we need to have sustainable heating, but that needs to be a just transition. And there was nothing just in the way that this was handled. We need to develop sustainable heating for rural areas. Simply imposing urban solutions doesn't work. And I would ask the Minister to give some thought to those currently on the cusp of installing efficient and sustainable wood-fired heating systems. They've been stopped in their tracks. And it seems to me perverse that a person can have a grant for installing such a system but can't get the building warrant to do the work. So I would ask the Minister perhaps to put in place a derogation for these new builds now to allow them to be completed, given the time that will pass before the review is complete. As she said herself, that won't be until after the summer. Guidance to local authority also needs to be consistent. Colleen and Neil and Shear's planning department deemed that the applications are unlikely to, warrant an exemption in any instance, whereas Highland Council, there has been a different interpretation depending on the specific location of the new build. Councils need to know what they can and cannot approve. Perhaps renewed guidance could be issued in the interim as well, so that much needed homes could be completed. Presiding Officer, a modern urban house can withstand a power cut for a few hours. And that, in truth, is probably as long as an urban power cut lasts. But the same modern home in a rural community needs to be able to withstand a power cut for a number of days, and even in extreme conditions, weeks. No house can hold heat for that long, and therefore they do need a secondary source of heat. The weather patterns also have an impact, as mentioned by Alistair Allen. It means that it might not be possible to heat a house from an ambient heating source alone, and realistically there may need to be a direct source of heating to work alongside this. What was even more perverse about the standards was that we were told emergency wood and heat-burning stoves needed to be portable. A solid fuel burner needs a chimney and therefore cannot be temporary or portable. Again, it was displaying total ignorance of the impact this policy would have if pursued. And I was having visions, I'm sure like many others, of people having to take their fire pit or their chimney inside from the garden, coughing and spluttering through the smoke. It was absolutely senseless. We need to rural-proof policies and have these policies developed by people who understand conditions in our rural areas, conditions in which our constituents live in. It adds insult to injury that those areas that already suffer the highest level of fuel poverty due to urban-centric policies are actually suffering the worst excesses of this because heat in their homes is far more expensive as it stands. The Change Works report of 2023 highlighted 1 in 4 homes in the Highlands and Islands are in extreme fuel poverty. And that same report highlighted that the fuel poverty gap in the Highlands and Islands, and that's the amount by which fuel bills need to be lowered to lift a household out of fuel poverty, was £1,260. And that compares with that same amount of £750 to move urban homes out of fuel poverty. So we need to address that.
Do you need to conclude?
I will conclude with that, but I think we need to have rural policies for rural heating, looking at things like HVO as well as heat as wood burning sources.
Thank you, Ms Grant. I now call Eleanor Whittam to be followed by Tess White, up to 4 minutes. Ms Whittam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank Jamie Halkrell-Johnson for securing this debate. Firstly, let me put on record that I am a homeowner of a very old property that benefits from a wood-burning stove that provides highly effective space heating as well as helping to prevent condensation, mould and damp. It's been actually a game changer for my gable wall in my house. It has also helped us to heat our sandstone home during periods of loss of power, and I know during any such prolonged period without mains power, it would also enable us to heat water and cook food. And it also has given us a degree of control over the volatile energy prices over the last 2 years. All of that said, though, I am very aware that the recently published new build heat standard would not, in fact, have prevented someone with the same house type as myself from installing a stove in an older existing property. But I'm also aware that the Scottish Government has recently consulted on creating a pathway to 2045 that could require those purchasing a home or business premises to end their use of polluting heating systems within a fixed period following the completion of the sale. I would assume that this would include direct emitting heat sources such as stoves and boilers, potentially leaving many homes like mine built in the 1800s with poorer heating outcomes. All of us do need to play our part when it comes to reaching net zero. And this will include radically rethinking many of the ways of working and living. But this does need to take into account the variation in geography, topography, grid connection and capacity, and conversely, our increasing volatile climate. And I think that's something that we need to think about because our climate is increasingly being volatile, but we need to make sure that what we're doing is not actually going to exacerbate this. So there's no doubt that burning of fossil fuels contributes to climate change and why addressing this via legislation is necessary. But I also understand, as the MSP for the large, predominantly rural Carrick-Cumnock-Hindon Valley constituency, that grid connections can be tenuous for outlying rural communities and isolated farms and cottages, and the stopgap for many of them is for heating and eating is a wood-burning stove. Indeed, during the horrendous weather event back in 2018, known as the Beast from the East, many folk in my area were snowed in for weeks and relied heavily upon their stoves. So not just a couple hours of a power cut, we're talking weeks at that time. Those in remote and rural, who are remote and rural from the grid infrastructure properties would still have a need for wood-burning stoves in such emergency situations. And they can't be portable. They need to be fixed. I understand that the new building heat standard made some provision for such emergency situations, but I and many others, we've already heard that today, felt that this was a bit vague and open to interpretation locally. So I would be really keen to hear from the Minister exactly how a house builder is able to demonstrate the need for a stove, as in my mind, it is almost a given in the rural settings. I also have a degree of sympathy for the arguments that burning dried wood from sustainable sources in a modern efficient stove or boiler does indeed have a lower carbon emission calculation than some grid resources. And we need to remember that. Indeed, many crofters and those living rurally have factored in access to sustainable forestry for energy provision into their way of life. We must ensure that we do not in any way exacerbate fuel poverty. I'm glad the Minister has taken our collective concerns seriously and is urgently reviewing the standard, and I'm really keen to hear from her today when she winds up about this. I also think it's really important in this place that we actually start to break down silos, because perhaps if this had come to the Rural and Islands Committee as well for some consideration, we would have been able to actually flag that up. And I do take on board the point that Miles Briggs did flag this up in the Local Government Committee. But just squaring that circle a little bit, I think, is something that we need to do. I'm also keen to bring to the Minister's attention a plight of one of my constituents who has brought this up recently in light of this debate. She's had a wood burner recently installed, but only found out when it was laterally inspected by a HETAS engineer that it was dangerous. So she has asked that she's very concerned about the lack of regulation for stove installation in Scotland, and has asked that the Scottish Government consider changes to legislation to only allow stove fitting by HETAS accredited installers. And I think that if we are going to make changes here and we are going to ensure that there is a place for stoves going forward, that that type of accreditation could be something we could look at. Thank you.
Sorry, I now call Tess White to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Up to 4 minutes, Ms White.
Presiding Officer, I'd also like to thank Jamie Halcrow-Johnson for securing the time for this evening's debate on banning wood-burning stoves in new-build homes. It's an opportunity for MSPs to scrutinise the Scottish Government's ill-conceived policy and, crucially, to raise the concerns of constituents about its impact. Yesterday, as we heard, Gillian Martin announced a review of the guidance. A review, Presiding Officer, is not the same as a reversal. It should not have taken public outcry and pressure from the Scottish Conservatives. Yes?
Minister, briefly.
I just want to ask Tess White if she agrees that it's important that I take time to reach out to stakeholders involved in this and hear their views on what they think about this, rather than just doing a knee-jerk action, as she suggests.
Tess White.
Thank you. Gillian Martin does raise the word knee-jerk. I think pot kettle on that one. And it's quite evident that Gillian Martin hasn't even listened to her own backbenchers and her own SNP party. So my point is, it shouldn't have taken a public outcry and pressure from the Scottish Conservatives to sense check this sorry episode. The new build heat standard isn't just an ill-conceived policy. It's another example of wokerity, wine bar, politicians being totally blinkered to the needs of rural Scotland. It was crafted by a central belt obsessed SNP government in hoc to the Scottish Greens before Patrick Harvey was unceremoniously told to get on his bike by the former First Minister. They've shown utter contempt for rural communities, the length and breadth of Scotland. They have totally, totally disregarded the financial impact of this policy on the stove industry and the sustainable biofuel companies which rely on it. The SNP have completely underestimated the realities of rural life. And need I remind the SNP government of Storm Arwen in November 2021 and the countless communities, some 4,000 people across the northeast, that lost power for days. One resident from Socken, Aberdeenshire, said the village was without power for a week. Luckily, he said, we have a wood-burning stove, so that kept us warm in one of the rooms. For thousands of people, they are a feature of rural resilience. The SNP can try all it wants to qualify, mitigate and dilute this policy. But when the experts like Royal Incorporation of Architects Scotland say that a more nuanced approach is needed, tailoring heating specifications to rural circumstances and real-world use scenarios, the SNP really do need to act. One stove industry representative from Angus said, when cars were deemed pollutants, no one suggested banning them. The industry was allowed to address the issues through improvement and innovation like catalytic converters and hybrid technology. The new build heat standard is a knee-jerk reaction.
Yeah. Briefly, Jamie Halker-Johnson.
I'm very grateful to Tess White for taking the intervention. I'm sure she's aware that actually the industry has worked with government to reduce emissions and worked extremely hard, and that's part of the great disappointment, that all that effort seems to be ignored in these new regulations.
Yeah, exactly. Ms White.
I do hope the Minister is listening very carefully, and we've got the industry in the galleries. Like other industry, transitioning of parts of net zero, the stove industry must have the opportunity to evolve and adjust. Regulations like these aren't simply a legacy of the disastrous Butte House Agreement, as Kate Forbes would have us believe. This is the way policy is made and imposed on rural and remote communities by this SNP government. And in closing, Presiding Officer, as Scottish land and estates have called for, the Scottish Government must change its approach to policy making. It must take account of rural proofing and improve consultation and communication. In the meantime, the Scottish Conservatives will keep standing up for the interests of our rural communities. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Alexander Burnett. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Burgess.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Jamie Halker-Johnson for securing the debate. Yesterday, we heard the Minister commit to the review of the new build heat standard. Presiding Officer, the new build heat standard is necessary to directly cut emissions from new homes and buildings and will help to stimulate the supply chain for zero carbon heating. It has been praised, and the UK government has been urged to bring forward its own measures to match Scotland's timetable. We're here now due to significant lobbying from manufacturers as well as some misinformation. And this has caused understandable concern for people who can make use of the flexibility that exists in the building standards, or for people who have existing biomass systems and have been misled to think that they will have to remove them. Presiding Officer, off the back of this lobbying and misinformation, I've heard from woodland crofters, design and build contractors, architects and self-builders, and community woodland groups, all of whom are concerned about the potential impact of the new standard on their projects. I met with members of the Isle of Egg Trust concerned about their need to install wood stoves as a primary source of heat for their new builds while they develop electric grid capacity in their move to net zero by 2030. And I thank the Minister for her reassurance that for off-grid communities like Egg, wood-burning stoves can be installed. The Scottish Government supports the creation of new woodland crofts. A key feature of such crofts is their self-sufficiency in heating fuel. More widely, occupiers of land such as crofters, farmers and owners of forests could sustainably grow all of their own fuel from their own land with minimal fuel miles, and corresponding benefits arising through managing that land for fuel, shelter, biodiversity, improved timber quality. To put people at ease, we must communicate that this standard is not a ban on biomass heating in existing homes. It is for new buildings and major rebuilding projects. I don't have time, sorry. It does not ban biomass as an emergency backup. It does not ban biomass as an emergency backup system, for example, in situations where electricity supply fails. The standard is implemented through the building standards regime, which already includes flexibility for local authorities to take account of special circumstances, for example, where homes need to be built in a place where they cannot have a reliable electricity supply. And I would ask the Minister to provide clear guidance to local authorities to apply the flexible approach where appropriate. A highly efficient wood-fueled heating system that minimises emissions and captures gases for additional burning, especially if powered through locally grown and harvested timber, could well have lower overall lifetime emissions than some zero direct emission systems. The standard will have small impact on biomass, since very few new homes are built with biomass as their main heating system. The number of situations where this is necessary, as I've described above, is so small that the flexibility in the regime will be able to cope. And again, I ask for the Minister to provide guidance to the standards at local authorities. Energy efficiency standards have also been increased in the building standards regime, and further changes will put in place a Scottish equivalent of the Passive House standard. And this means that the energy demand for heating All new homes will be very low, which will further reduce the already rare instances where zero-emission heating is not viable. Biomass has a role to play in home heating, and this will be most relevant for existing homes whose characteristics make them especially difficult or expensive to retrofit for energy efficiency and zero-emissions heating. And where a sustainable supply of feedstock is readily available and can be relied upon for the long term. However, putting it into new buildings still generates avoidable gas emissions. Doing so out of necessity in circumstances where no zero emissions options can be made viable is justified. These concerns that have been raised are understandable, but they are a result from lack of a clear commitment from SNP ministers reconfirming the direction of travel
conclude.
On the wider heat and building strategy and the intention to introduce legislation this year. Only this clear signal will create the conditions for the investment that is needed in skills,
do you need to conclude?
Supply chain and innovation.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. Before I call the next speaker, I'm minded there are still a large number of members wishing to participate, and on that basis I'm minded to take a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I invite Jamie Halker-Johnston to move such a motion.
Happy to move.
Thank you. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? Unanimously agreed. I therefore call Alexander Burnett to be followed by Christine Graham. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I promise to be brief and not use the 30 minutes extended. Can I start by thanking Jamie Halker-Johnston for bringing this very important issue to debate, and just note my register of interest relating to renewable energy, biomass and forestry. As we've heard from colleagues throughout the debate, this issue deeply impacts those in our rural communities, along with anyone who would enjoy the freedom of having a wood-burning stove for heat and comfort. Many of my constituents in Aberdeenshire West have expressed their concerns about how they will stay warm during future power cuts. Extreme weather events are sadly becoming too frequent. Power cuts can last days, if not weeks, and I myself was without power for 10 days during Storm Arwen. However, my additional concern with this ban from a renewable energy perspective is that it sends a message that biomass and wood fuel will become prohibited down the line. With thousands of people having been encouraged, including myself, to invest in various wood fuel systems, this is extremely concerning. Many public authorities have also gone down this route. Highland Council, for instance, has dozens of schools on wood fuel, and I hope the Minister will assure all of us relying on wood fuel that support and encouragement for the sector still exists. This effective ban on wood-burning stoves for new homes is the start of a slippery slope to wiping out the sector altogether. Colleagues have raised the significant economic impact that this will have on jobs and local businesses, the livelihoods of the 2,000 who work on the sector, and the £60 million it contributes annually to our Scottish economy. Now, I promised I'd be brief, and I'll finish on just a specific point. Managing forestry is a long and costly process, and any wood products that can be extracted are critical for what is a very difficult economic sector. Firewood is obviously the lowest value-added product, and there have been support for schemes such as woodlots, the forestry equivalent of allotments, to maintain small areas of non-commercial forestry. So if we want to support the forest sector and the environmental benefits that stem from that, we must understand the economics of the sector. This Parliament sadly has a reputation for pursuing ideological ambition with ignorance and disregard for the people and sectors it impacts. So yet again, it is clear that these regulations must be rethought. Thank you. I've just finished.
I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Finlay Carson. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm a wee bit peeved that the SNP are being accused of being anti-rural. Many of my colleagues have spoken up for rural communities for generations, and I've done it for 25 years. I've had to get that off my chest. I congratulate the member on securing this debate and was pleased to sign his motion debated today. And as the Minister is aware, I raised my concerns about the limitations and restrictions on new builds of log-burning stoves, as that would impact on many households and indeed businesses in my rural constituency. Because we're not talking about the fashion to have these in the city, but the fact for centuries in rural Scotland, people have warmed their homes with a ready and inexpensive and sometimes free supply of logs. When I lived in Minigaff near Newton Stewart, I had a trailer deliver over the summer a supply of logs to stack and dry for the winter.
We had no mains access to gas, and after many a storm, the electricity supply would cut out. Candles were easily located, and not for the first time I had to cook on that open log-burning fire. And that remains the case in many rural areas in my constituency today. Now, some of this is historic, but I'm going to say it anyway. I raised my concerns at FNQs on the 20th of April, and I quote, "There is a well-established business in West Linton that supplies log-burning stoves and accessories. I'm very concerned that after 30 years, the business may very well be under threat. I understand that clean, eco-designed wood-burning stoves that use locally supplied wood can be used in conjunction with other renewable energy heating options, and that that position is supported by a government study that was done a few years ago. Will the First Minister ask the appropriate Cabinet Secretary to revisit that study, as the issue may affect other small rural businesses?" And the First Minister then, Hamza Yousaf, replied, and I quote, "I will ensure that we continue to keep those regulations under review. I say to Christine Graham that there are appropriate exemptions in place and we take account of unique circumstances, particularly in rural and island Scotland." Now, I followed this up on May the 22nd at Portfolios when I asked the Scottish Government what discussions it had with rural communities such as the residents and businesses in Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale regarding the restriction on the installations of wood-burning stoves. And the Minister, Gillian Martin, replied, quote, "The new build heat standard currently applies only to new buildings and certain conversions. Wood-burning stoves can still be installed, provide emergency heating when justified." Now, of course, one of the, close quotes, one of the concerns is the use of the word emergency. Back to the quote. "I'm new in this post. We are urgently reviewing the position in light of those concerns and ensuring that we work with and communicate with all concerned parties, including businesses. As we do so, I believe I already said I would go to Ms Graham's constituency to speak to one such business." Now, I had forgotten the invitation, typical of me, but the Minister has agreed to come and has agreed. She said the following. "I made a good point about sustainable supply of fuels for these forms of heating. I assure her that I take very seriously the concerns that she and many others have raised. I am happy to reiterate the commitment to urgently review our position," which she's doing, close quotes, "which was made in the letter of 16th May, and she accepted my second invitation to go to the constituency." The point is, that second invitation, the first was to Dryden Aqua. I don't want the Minister to get confused, because that's about recycling glass. The second is to visit the Fireside Shop in West Linton, which stands, and I know it's in the post here. But I want to add a third invitation, because I'm very good at invitations. This is to Baddingsgill Farm, which is nearby West Linton. It trades also as tree-lined. It sells bagged logs, kiln-dried, hardwood, and what it calls wee wonky wood for log burners. This is local wood, burned locally, and simply by being local reduces emissions. We could tackle these at the same time. And I think this is an important thing, is to work with rural communities, work with domestic communities and business communities, because we all want to play our part in reducing emissions, but we have to do it together and nuanced and flexibly. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I now call Finlay Carson to be followed by Emma Harper. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Carson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Before I begin, can I thank my colleague Jamie Halker-Johnson for bringing this member's debate to the Chamber. As we've already heard, the stove industry in the UK and here in Scotland makes a valuable contribution to our economy, both financially and in terms of employment. The most recent figures show that the sector contributed £750 million annually and supports 25,000 jobs, something that absolutely should not be ignored in this debate. Nor should the fact that log-burning stoves have been a vital mainstay for many communities in rural Scotland down the generation, especially as many homes have no access to mains gas supply and some are so remote that they have no reliable electricity services during the winter. And that's not going to be any different for new builds. So, as we are aware, in recent years we have witnessed a string of devastating storms that have left many rural and island communities without power, on some occasions for several days, often amid chilling temperatures. Unexpected interruption of power is no longer a rarity, and Highland Council now recommends that in the winter you might need to be self-sufficient for 72 hours. It's well publicised that after Storm Arwen, as many as 4,000 people were without power for a whole week. Consumer Scotland has also highlighted the issue of infrastructure resilience in rural parts of Scotland, like my own constituency of Galloway in West Dumfries and Kristen Graham's old home in Minigaff. So having wood-burning stoves have provided a godsend for many emergency situations, allowing families and others to have backup warmth as well as cooking facilities. But perhaps putting aside all the resilience, climate and economic factors, did you know that the wood-burning stoves or an open fire is actually good for your health and personal well-being, with as many as 93% of us, reporting an advantageous effect? According to research, the warmth, light, sound and smell of a fire can have direct benefits on an individual's blood pressure and stress levels, and I absolutely need to get one installed. The circulatory system is complex and is influenced and managed by mental images and emotions. The presence of a flame, including stoves, fireplace inserts or candles within a household, can provide connotations of homeliness and safety. And this is well documented in Scandinavian countries, where residential combustion is more commonplace and where the term hygge has been, and I think I pronounced that right, hygge, has been used to describe this ambient mood. In fact, the use of a fireplace or stove, often within a central living space, provides a central focal point within a household, encourage communication and between family members, leading to a friendly and creative discussion. So the next time the other half, or the wains, or the dog, are getting stressed, simply turn on the fire or stove and watch your troubles melt away. And you can thank me later for that advice, Minister. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, if you're looking for a stress-free, healthy life in your tradition, or indeed new-built home, then wood-burning stoves are the answer.
Thank you, Mr Carson. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Edward Mountain. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, and I will keep my contribution really brief, as colleagues have described the issues really well already, and I've scribbled out loads of what I was going to say. I thank Jamie Halker-Johnson for bringing the debate forward, and I also want to thank the stove industries and the stove architects and land and estates for their briefings ahead of the debate. And we've heard that some of the content of the heat in buildings built has been controversial, particularly for people in remote and rural and island communities. And we've heard that across chamber from rural colleagues today. My inbox has had muckle contact from people across Dumfries and Galloway and the borders. And in Eleanor Whittam's contribution, she mentioned grid connection. Indeed, according to the Scottish Government's own estimates, 34% of dwellings in Dumfries and Galloway are off the gas grid, and that's a higher proportion than for the whole of Scotland, which has an average of 16%. Many of these homes, my constituents, rely on wood-burning stoves and biomass boilers for heating and for their hot water and also for cooking, and others have said that already. And as was confirmed by the Minister at the topical question on Tuesday, she listened to the concerns raised by rural communities. The Minister stated that she will be willing to review the proposed regulations on wood-burning stoves and biomass boilers with the intention to adapt them to address the issues of inflexibility that have been raised. And I know this will be welcome news for my constituents who have contacted me about this. For people in rural Wigtonshire, Dumfriesshire and for the borders, there exists deep concern over the current proposals. And in particular, I was also contacted by constituents over the cost of having to change their whole heating system away from wood-burning stoves and biomass boilers, particularly at a time of energy poverty and a Westminster-inflicted cost-of-living crisis. The Minister's announcement is therefore an example of how the Government will listen to the views of rural Scotland and ensure policy works for everyone. And I agree with Eleanor Whittam when she said that perhaps as well as... Let me just finish this wee point. I agree with Eleanor Whittam that when she said that as well as local government committee, that this could have come to rural committee also. That was... part of an issue I raised recently about cross-committee, cross-portfolio working. And we saw this with the Good Food Nation Bill, which only went to the Rural Committee, and it didn't even come to the Health Committee. And I'm a member of both, and I see a warrant of cross-portfolio working, and I will take that intervention.
Jamie Halker-Johnson, briefly.
I'm grateful to Emma Harper taking the intervention, and I agree with her on terms of the cross-party and the point that Eleanor Whittam said about silos. And I recognise that this is maybe not a mess of this minister's making, but less than two months after these regulations have been introduced, they're having to be reviewed. It is not a case of the Scottish Government listening to rural communities. They should have done that before these were brought in.
Emma Harper.
So I thank Jamie Harker-Johnson for that intervention. My understanding that the review has already started and it's already taken place. But again, it perhaps highlights the fact that sometimes the steps that are taken, we need to have the voices of more cross-party, cross-portfolio working. My colleague Brian Whittle has said that as well in another debate that we had recently. I understand time is tight, presiding officer, so I know the Minister has already undertaken this review. I look forward to the review. We know we need to decarbonise heating in our homes, so I look forward to the progress as we take this forward. So now stop there, presiding officer.
Thank you, Ms Harper. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Edward Mountain, up to 4 minutes. Mr.
Thank you very much, presiding officer, and I'm very conscious about the time constraints. But having extended it by 30 minutes, I think I've got 15 minutes left. But I'm not going to talk about that. But I am going to thank Jamie Halcrow-Johnson for bringing this debate to the Parliament. It is really important. Every time I go home, some of the more rural constituents that I face ask what I do down here. And I can't believe that I was forcing to try and argue the defence of a ban on wood-burning stoves. I don't need to remind the Minister that in 2012, we were in a situation in the area where I live that for 3.5 months, no lorries could come either anywhere near my home to deliver oil or gas, and the electricity was pretty shaky on occasions. So the log-burning stove was actually critically important. Also, they say to me, what are you going to do with all the wood that's left up in the forestry? And I said, well, we can't chip it anymore. But they say, oh, yes, you can chip it, of course, Edward. You can send it down to the local cord plant in Rothes, next to where they're building these new houses, and they can get a government grant for burning it. But we can't burn it in our own houses. That's what they don't understand. They don't understand why this plan was brought about without considering rural areas. And I could bang on for ages about this. I'm not going to. I'm glad we're having a review. I'm glad we're thinking that it's probably not a wise idea. And I'm glad that our party and other members across the chamber have pointed this out to the government. And I'm glad that the government now is in a position, without Mr. Harvey there, to actually consider reversing this idea. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, and I am glad that you didn't take 15 minutes, Mr. Mountain. And with that, I call on Gillian Martin to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you. I really welcome this debate. I want to start with thank Jamie Harcourt-Johnson and thank members across the Chamber for the nearly 100% constructive tone, because I find myself nodding along to most of the points that have been made. Obviously, the anti-SNP stuff I'm just going to shrug off. But I think the concerns that have been highlighted echo my own, and echoed my own before I had responsibility for this. And I was particularly aware about having had responsibility before for fuel poverty and just transition, that these regulations maybe didn't hit the mark on those two areas. And also, as a rural MSP myself, I was acutely aware of the importance of having wood-burning stoves as an option, also biomass boilers as an option as well. And not just for existing homes, but for new builds as well. I'll take Ms. Hamilton.
Rachel Hamilton.
Taking the intervention. But, you know, we have trust that you will take this, or you're committing to take this review forward in a different way to as it was 2 months ago. So why initially were the industry bodies not consulted, particularly the stove industry? And will they be consulted? And will Gillian Martin commit to meeting with the cross-party members and stakeholders?
Minister.
As I said to Ms Hamilton yesterday when she asked me a topical question on this, I mean, that's why I reviewed. So that's why I effectively said to Tess White, you know, who wants me to do this tomorrow, that it's important that I listen to stakeholders. I'm happy to meet the Stove Industry Association. I've got a member of the association as a constituent of mine who came to see me as a constituency MSP a couple of weeks back as well. But we're already looking at what can actually happen in the interim period, because obviously a review has to take place. and to allow conversations such as Ms Hamilton has mentioned. But I am very conscious of the fact that there has to be interim solutions as well. Rhoda Grant brought that up as well. My officials are actually meeting tomorrow and are going to report back to me with the local authorities, Building Standards Scotland officers as well. Really it's about guidance at the moment. I mean, obviously there's the regulations, but there's the guidance and the flexibility there. Rhoda Grant made a really important point about building warrants, and I'm going to see what that conversation brings out in terms of what I can do in the interim period. I'll take Mr Harkle-Johnson.
Jamie Harkle-Johnson.
Thanks. I'm pleased to hear that your officials are looking at. Could those considerations include a suspension of the regulations, or at least a presumption against, or a removal of a presumption against wood-burning stoves? And also, given that damage has already been done to this sector, as I asked yesterday, will you look at doing an economic impact assessment on the impact of the regulation so far?
Through the chair, Minister.
My biggest concern at the moment is making sure that the unintended consequences of these regulations is not going to have more of an impact. And that's why it's a case of, in terms of the regulations, that obviously has to go through a parliamentary process as well. And Mr. Harkle-Johnson knows that well. But what can I do in the interim period? It's clear that I did actually make representation around the emergency situation that many people found themselves during power cuts. But I don't think, in all honesty, people put a biomass boiler in for an emergency. And I think that that's, you're not going to spend that money for just an emergency situation. And how do those regulations, what constitutes an emergency? And I'm very alive to the fact that there would be people that would be putting in biomass boilers for, primary and secondary heating as well. I'm not going to take another intervention because I've got loads to say, Mr. Harkle-Johnson, and I'm sure that I might even answer your question. I had those concerns. I still have those concerns as well. So the guidelines around emergency, I think, needed looked at. They're going to be looked at as well. I heard the range of concerns raised by communities. I'm actively working on interim solutions. I'm actively involved in this review. I have been raising this as an issue as soon as I got responsibility, and obviously you heard my response to Ms Hamilton yesterday. The debate has highlighted the unique challenges facing rural communities, including the need of resilience around power cuts as well. Storm Garrett was mentioned by Mr Harkle-Johnson. A few people mentioned Storm Arwen. My constituency was impacted by Storm Arwen as well. Interestingly, a lot of people after Storm Arwen who weren't affected, who didn't have a wood-burning stove, thought about putting one in should anything like that happen again. Again, we're talking about existing homes here as well. Existing homes, but also new builds as well. You're thinking, how can I future-proof them? Extreme weather events have been mentioned. I think it was Alexander Burnett mentioned about extreme weather events, and there's going to be more. This is the thing. Extreme weather events as a result of climate change. So we have to be proportionate. The problem that we have here is that I think that the regulations didn't quite take into account that there had to be flexibility in rural areas for all the reasons that people have mentioned as well. And even I'm going to quote Chris Stark, actually. Chris Stark, the former CEO of the Climate Change Committee, who said on Twitter, he agreed with the regulations on the whole, but admitted as well, he said, the wood burner proposals are far too inflexible. I agree. And I agree with him. I'll take Finn Carson.
Finlay Carson, briefly.
I really appreciate the Minister giving the intervention. Will you give us a commitment today? You'll also look at the future of wood burning stoves in new builds, because what we've currently got is myths that are peddled by the Green Party that there's some significant impact in the climate by these wood burning stoves. The industry have invested millions to ensure that they're some of the most effective ways to heat your home. And why should new homes not have the advantage that I set out in well-being with little impact? The Greens would have us banning air fryers, because they actually have a significantly more impact on the climate than wood-burning stoves ever would have.
Thank you, and through the chair, please, Minister, for a
debate about heat generation, let's take the heat out of this, and I think that actually we need to work cross-party on this. Effectively, what Mr Carson has asked me to do, I am doing. It is about new builds. I mean, this is a very small part of the regulations. It's not throwing out all the regulations. It's looking at this very small part that is causing such concern in rural communities. I want to turn to fuel poverty. Obviously, I have had responsibility for fuel poverty since I was made a minister last year. Elaine Witham mentions that. I want to reassure members that continue to follow the principles set in a heat and building strategy to make sure that people are not pushed into fuel poverty in the process of anything they're doing to decarbonise homes. I think that's really important. Again, it's a just transition issue as well. The regulations don't exist in isolation. They build upon recent uplift in energy standards. They ensure that new buildings have high levels of energy efficiency as well. But I think it's about recognising that in some areas where people are doing everything they can to decarbonise and everything they can to be sustainable, there are very many people who have their own sustainable wood supply. Edward Mountain mentioned that as well. You know, Alexander Burnett mentioned that as well. Elena Whittam mentioned that as well. And I think that is something that I really need to consider as I look at the review of these regulations as well. But we also need to support grid upgrades to make sure that more communities have sustainable electricity supplies as well. Because these extreme weather events are one thing, but also we have got a grid infrastructure for electricity that is needing dramatic investment that's going to get made as well. So I think we have to look at all of this in the round and stop making that as a political football as well. The context in which we're having this debate is in the reality of a climate emergency. It's a clear priority of this government to take urgent action to reduce emissions. But let's look at the percentage of new builds that actually put in wood-burning stoves. It was a fraction of Scotland. We can't throw the baby out with the bathwater here, you know. But there's a fraction, I'm saying, in terms of emissions that they're creating. It is not a substantial amount of homes. And for those homes, people are not making those decisions based on wanting to do anything to pollute. They're making those decisions for the good of their family, for the circumstances that they find themselves in. And we have to be absolutely alive to that. I'm alive to that. I, like Emma Harper and Christine Graham, I actually take offence for people saying that I don't understand rural Scotland. I am a rural Scotland MSP, and I have consistently stood up for rural Scotland. I am now in the position to review these guidelines. I hope everyone will take me at my word that I am treating this as an urgent matter. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.